Welcome to Plain Township's second annual Salute to Veterans. Would like to give a very special thank you for our color guard as well as our honor guard. We've got the Ohio Patriot Guard right behind us, so let's give them a round of applause for everything. As well, we've got an amazing group of young individuals down here, the Junior ROTC. Let's please give them a special round. You know, events and programs like this don't come together by an individual or maybe even just a few individuals. It takes an entire team. And it's exciting to have an entire team here of so many community partners. Literally, I'd probably take the next 30 minutes talking through all the partners that have collaborated with us. So let me just say, for everybody who is a sponsor, not only of the Salute to Veterans event, but the Blue Star Memorial dedication and the remaining dedication of our Veterans Memorial, we are grateful. We're honored to have all of you here. Quite frankly, it's very humbling, it's very moving, and as much as I like to typically talk, it's difficult to have the honor of standing before each and every one of you that's served or are serving. I do have a couple individuals that I'd like to introduce here at our head table. So if you'll bear with me, on my left, your right, we have our Township Administrator, Ms. Lisa Campbell. Next, we have former Plain Township Trustee and your current Stark County Clerk of Courts, Mr. Lou Giabasis. We have Plain Township's new Fire Chief, Mr. Charles Chuck Schallenberger. We have our distinctive and honored keynote speaker, retired two-star Major General Dan Hahn. To my right, your left, Trustee Albert Lino. Former Fire Chief, current Trustee, Mr. John Sabo. We have from Plain Local Schools, Superintendent, Mr. Brent May. Assistant Superintendent, Mr. Brian Matthews. The Davy Tree Expert Company, and my wife, Laura Hawes. And at the end, we have Mr. Howard Wenger, who was very instrumental in the Keystone Monument site work. So if we'll give him a round of applause as well. So without any further ado, so we can get into our program, it's my honor and my privilege to have my wife, Davy Tree Executive, Laura Weimer Hawes. Please come forward. She's going to introduce our keynote speaker.
Good morning. It's such an honor to be here today. And on behalf of the Davy Tree Expert Company and its 8,000 plus employees, we say thank you. I also have the pleasure of introducing our keynote speaker today. So please, let me tell you a little bit about him. Dan Hahn retired from the Army as a Major General in October 2009 with 36 years of service. He grew up in Ohio, graduated from the United States Military Academy at West Point in 1973, and commissioned a second lieutenant. He has served throughout the U.S. and the world. He commanded an artillery battalion during Desert Storm in 1991, and had two assignments in the Pentagon on the Joint and Army Staffs. He served six different tours in Europe and one in Korea. Promoted to brigadier general in 2001. He had two tours in Iraq. 2003 as a chief of staff of ground forces, and 2006 as a deputy commander of multinational corps. His last assignment from 2007 to 2009 was senior operations officer at NATO headquarters in the Netherlands, with responsibility for NATO Afghanistan operations. He has numerous awards and decorations, including the Distinguished Service Medal and 3 Bronze Star Medals. He earned his bachelor's degree from West Point, an MBA from Southern Illinois University, Edwardsville, and a master's in military art and science from the School of Advanced Military Studies. Dan is president of the board of directors for the military's Veterans Resource Center, an organization dedicated to help veterans. He served as president of Ohio Western Reserve Chapter of the Military Officers Association of America from 2013 to 2014, and is actively involved in the support of ROTC and veteran support activities. He has given numerous Memorial and Veterans Day presentations in communities throughout the area since 2010. Dan is married to the former Carol Sharton of East Canton for 42 years. They have 2 children and 5 girl children and currently reside in North Canton, Ohio. Please, let's welcome Major General Dan Hahn.
I'm glad to see that Junior ROTC is seated, but the band is standing, so I apologize. You know, in my military career, I always worried about giving talks when the troops are standing, but at least it's not raining on you here today. Before I get started, I just want to thank all the people for the ceremony that we just had, and I know there's a follow-on ceremony. I know these things aren't easy to put on, but I consider the ceremony this morning a gift, and you know, it was a great ceremony, and it inspired me, and particularly the high school choral group. And as I looked at the diversity of that group, what I saw is the America I know. And it looked like your average, everyday military unit with the amount of diversity. And I also wanted to thank the Akron-Buchtel ROTC detachment that's here today. Thanks for what you're doing and beginning your career here in the United States of America. And then also thanks to the guard, honor guard here behind me. You were here last year. I failed to mention you, and I think you've gotten better work. So thank you for the opportunity to speak in honor of all our veterans at this Veterans Day ceremony. Thanks, Laura, for the kind introduction. Thanks to Scott Hall and all the trustees for your efforts to make this important event possible. Thanks to Rob Steinberg, in the Parks Department for preparing the park for this event. And thanks to all the people who helped make the dedication of the Blue Star Memorial here this morning. And I also want to thank the STEM Academy students at Glen Oak High School who began last year, I know, in the help of design for the Memorial Park and the layout, and that's just a beautiful setting up there. Also, I would give special thanks to the Glen Oak Band for playing the national anthem, and I think they'll be playing again, and you have truly made this a first-class event. Finally, thanks to all the veterans and their family members in attendance here. Thank you all for your service, and let's give our veterans a round of applause. Now, Veterans Day was first proclaimed on November 11, 1919 by President Woodrow Wilson and was to commemorate the armistice for World War I, the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month. This was a date and time of cessation of hostilities in 1918. The celebration was called Armistice Day until it was officially changed by law to Veterans Day in 1954. Veterans Day is set to honor the service of all U.S. military veterans, not to be confused with Memorial Day, which is a day that pays homage to all those men and women who died while serving their country. The number of men and women serving their country in uniform has declined to 0.5% of Americans. This is truly our smallest minority and deserves our greatest support. This means that the veteran population will continue to decline, and currently the veteran population is 21,368,000. There are around 860,000 veterans here in Ohio. The Veterans Administration now estimates that the number of living World War II veterans is 696,000. There were originally 17,900,000 who served in World War II. Vietnam-era veterans are our largest veteran population as around 34%, followed by our Gulf War veterans at 28.5%, and they will soon be our largest veteran population. As the number of veterans declines, the power of their votes will decline, and we, the people, will have to maintain support for them. Now, I would highlight that the nation had veterans before the Constitution was signed in 1787, and of course, these were the Revolutionary War veterans. From the beginning, our country has struggled to take care of veterans. Most Revolutionary War soldiers were never paid for their service, even though serving for 6 or 7 years. By the end of the war in 1783, the states had only paid $125,000 of $6 million owed. The federal government had no money and no way to raise taxes until the Constitution was ratified. Many officers would end up in debtors' prison for after 6 to 8 years of service without pay. Their personal affairs and that of their families were a shambles. Many of them had financed the war with their own resources. For enlisted soldiers, the plight was equally bad and sometimes worse because they had no skills to fall back on to earn a living, many being teenagers when they enlisted. Connecticut Sergeant John Martin is an example of those veterans who tried to get the land bounties and other pensions or monetary awards that were promised in their enlistment contract. Sergeant Martin was a hardcore veteran of 7 years in the Continental Army. Like most veterans, he expected the country to reward him for his service. Indeed, numerous legislative acts have been passed promising payments, pensions, or land for serving the duration of the war. In an 1830 memoir, a narrative of some of the adventures, dangers, and sufferings of a revolutionary soldier, Sergeant Martin demanded to know why Congress and the people had failed to deliver. Why were he and his fellow soldiers turned adrift like old, worn-out horses? How was it that impoverished soldiers had to sell their land claims to a pack of speculators? Why, having spent his youth suffering everything short of death in his country's cause, did poverty still haunt him all his life? And why, when the United States government finally provided a soldier's pension in 1818, 35 years after the war, did Martin and his fellow veterans face scorn? And people say that soldiers never deserved such favor from the country. Now, President Calvin Coolidge stated during his presidency in the 1920s that the nation which forgets its defenders will itself be forgotten. During his presidency, he struggled with funding bonuses for World War I veterans and had to work through the scandals surrounding President Harding's establishment of the original Veterans Bureau and the development of hospitals and medical care for Spanish American and World War veterans. Now, there are many other stories that I could tell after each of our cohort of wars, but I don't have the time to get into it. But the point is, the struggles we have today are not new. So we hear about many veteran issues in our country, and they need to be addressed. There are approximately 1.3 million veterans living in poverty. about 50,000 homeless veterans and 5.3% unemployed, although the number of veterans not working is higher. However, today I do not want to dwell on these struggles, but rather to highlight the contributions of veterans to our society and the world. Our veterans have always been unique and special, and I will use the word exceptional. They embody the idea of selfless service and willing to give their life for the defense of their country and families, to fight for freedom all over the world and live and die for each other as a team to accomplish the missions the nation requires. The legacy of this selfless service is handed down from the Revolutionary War Army. General George Washington understood the Revolutionary Army was unique and had the opportunity to set precedents for the world. For the first time, an army was fighting for human freedom and not for imperialistic or dynastic ambitions. Further, this was not a group of mercenaries who were doing it for pay. As Don Higginbotham points out in his book, The American War of Independence, Washington took every opportunity to instruct his troops and officers and place this information in his general orders. On the day that Congress voted for independence, Washington wrote to his army, "The fate of unborn maidens will now depend under God on the courage and conduct of this army." Washington warned that if the American experiment in self-rule should fail, owing to defeat on the battlefield or because of apathy behind the lines, then Americans would sacrifice not only their own country, but all mankind as well. For the revolution, in its broad implications, suggested that a better way of life was possible for people everywhere. Our troops of today are motivated to give the same selfless service to the nation because they believe in our country and that it represents freedom and hope for people around the world. It was truly my honor to lead such men and women. I have talked to veterans from World War II to the present, and they express this spirit and the importance of serving their country. World War II veterans liberated Europe and the peoples of the Far East. During the World War, over 70 million people died, so this is not a trivial issue. I think the feelings of our World War II veterans can best be summed up in the words of my sister-in-law's father, who fought as a Marine in the Pacific and fought on Iwo Jima. He sent me the book, Flag of Our Fathers, which is a story of the six men who raised the flag on Mount Suribachi, Iwo Jima. And the picture of this event is now commemorated as a Marine Corps monument in Washington, D.C., and shortly before he died 2 years ago. I received this book from his father-in-law, and Marvin Burdine autographed the book for me and penned the following note inside the front cover. "Iwo Jima was hell on earth, but it was the most important thing I ever did." This is the sentiment of most World War II veterans, but they remain humble and they will generally not talk about their experiences. The Korean War veterans fought in the Forgotten War, and their contributions to freedom in the world are underappreciated. Not much is written about this war, and much of this is forgotten history. However, I would like to highlight the importance of what our Korean War veterans accomplished. The country viewed this war as incomplete or a failure because it didn't have a final ending like World War II, where enemies were destroyed and countries defeated. However, in hindsight, the country of South Korea was given the opportunity to build their country as a result of what the Korean War veterans accomplished. They maintained the integrity of the South Korean country and government. Since the end of the war, the South Koreans have had a strong economic recovery and have become a democratic state. In the history of the world, perhaps no country has been so totally destroyed as a result of the Japanese occupation of World War II and then the Korean War from 1950 to 53. Most veterans remember the total destruction of the country by the war and the deplorable plight of the South Korean people. The conditions we see in the country today are a tribute to the Korean people, but it is also a tribute to the opportunity that our Korean War veterans gave them. I would also mention that 20 other nations were involved as allies in the war, and their contributions were not insignificant. Also, the United States has stayed the course throughout the Cold War and continues until today to continue to help guarantee the security of South Korea, and many veterans have served in South Korea since the war. The fact that North Korea remains a threat does not diminish the freedom and well-being that the people of South Korea experience today. Perhaps the title should not be The Forgotten War, but The Forgotten Victory. This is a term used by Jong-Woo Han, the president of the Korean War Legacy Foundation. He is a former professor from Syracuse University with a PhD in history. He is working to preserve the legacy of our Korean War veterans and is working to preserve their memories and memorabilia through his Korean War Digital Memorial. His website has many interviews with Korean War veterans throughout this country and other countries who were participants in the war. Let us give another round of applause and thanks to our Korean War veterans, which has not been duly given. Now, if Korea was a forgotten war, the Vietnam War was reviled and never understood. The veterans of this war received little respect or honor at the time, and while they are respected today, there has not been much attempt to put this war as part of the Cold War in proper historical perspective. These are the thoughts of a Vietnam veteran draftee, Elliot Lloyd. I served a 14-month tour of duty, December 13, 1968 through February 17, 1970. As a citizen soldier, the Vietnam experience was not something I volunteered for. However, I do not regret it, although it came with a price I value it highly. Serving in the Army taught me the value of physical fitness, hard work, discipline, teamwork, setting an objective and achieving it. All of these values have helped me achieve success in civilian life. It also opened my eyes to the challenges that third world countries face, as well as the knowledge that people from other races and cultures share the same hopes and dreams we do. One last thought relative to readjustment to civilian life. Civilians have a hard time understanding that when one joins the Army, that it is not just an occupation, but a way of life. Especially in a war zone, soldiers are on call 24 hours a day. But it is more than that, it is an attitude. Once you get on that airplane or ship headed for the war zone, the dice have been rolled. You knowingly accept whatever fate has in store for you. It takes real courage to do that. Those who have made that decision in the past and those who will make it in the future deserve to be celebrated by a grateful nation. Whether men or women, they are warriors. His words sum up the ideas of selfless service and also give an indication of the quality of our veterans as citizens. The most important message is that the contribution of veterans have been great throughout our history. This is not often emphasized. First, 26 of our nation's 44 and now 45 presidents have been veterans. Importantly, veterans have served their country and communities across the nation. Veterans have become teachers, coaches, business owners and leaders, mothers and fathers, leaders of charitable organizations, and yes, even go into politics. This has been true since the beginning of the United States. There are some other statistics that you might find about veterans that you might find surprising. Most veterans are successful, and their median income, both men and women, are higher than non-veterans. Veterans own 9% of all businesses in the United States, which accounts for $1.2 trillion in revenue and employs 5.8 million people. Most World War II and Korean veterans are retired, and many of the Gulf War veterans have not been out of the military service long enough to establish themselves, so many of these businesses are owned by Vietnam War veterans. Let us hope that the Gulf War veterans will do as well, because our country needs them to become successful and continue to serve our country. Veterans are talented people. Now let me close with a story about a recent Gulf War veteran. I first became familiar with this story from a Veterans Day special issue of Parade Magazine, an interview from November 11, 2011. He served in Iraq from 2003 through early 2004. His name is Jonas Hagos and is now about 35. He left the military and has become a successful businessman. At the end of October this year, he has opened a Dunkin' Donuts Baskin Robbins in Quincy, Illinois, and has hired more than 60 people. He already owns several other Dunkin' Donuts in Illinois. Now, Jonas is a special and unique individual. He came from Africa, and his mother and father came from Ethiopia, but he was born in a refugee camp in Sudan and lived there for the first 9 years of his life. His father left and came to the United States to get started in Chicago and brought his family sometime later, which in itself is an incredible story. Jonas lived in a housing project. And so let me read a couple of things from the interview here, which express it better than I can. He's talking about his father. He came and picked us up. Now, coming from a poor country, I didn't think much of it. But when I saw the car, I'm like, wow, my dad got a four-door car. Obviously, it was a used car. It was a little beater, but I didn't know that. And then we walked into the two-bedroom apartment. There's six of us, including my mom and dad, and he said, this is where you guys are going to sleep. There's two beds, single beds. I was excited. Back in Sudan, there were four of us sleeping on one bed with no mattress, just on the springs. But sometimes you're sleeping on the floor. And to me, this is wild. And in his words, we were surrounded in this housing project by gangbangers and drug dealers. And so he says, I knew moving ahead I needed to do something, and I didn't want to get drawn into selling drugs or gangbanging. And at the same time, I wanted to do something with my life. More importantly, I wanted to pay back America for what it's given me. So after high school, I was going to a community college, and I couldn't really afford it, and 9/11 happened. It really woke me up. I said, do I sit back and pretty much mooch off the country, or do I go and do something about it? So I enlisted in December 2002. And so if the story ended here, his accomplishments are incredible, but there is more. In April 2004, he was wounded in Iraq. He almost lost his life and lost portions of his shoulder. And this is the story of how his life was saved, or as he says it, what saved my life was the medic, the female medic. I'll never forget it. Her reaction to get the IV going and trying to stop the bleeding and calming me down, helping me. I got AeroVac to the hospital in the green zone, which came under heavy attack. They shot an RPG through my window, but the generator in front of the window stopped it. After that, I had surgery. The next morning, they woke me up. I had another surgery. They flew me into Balad, which was like a tent city. There was an airbase there. He was told that he would never have more than 50% mobility, but through his determination, he now has 95% mobility. Of course, he had PTSD with lots of nightmares about his experience. He finally decided to get rid of his medication, and in his words, I threw them out. I just find that by working out, staying in shape, staying focused and on the task. So he is now a successful businessman, and he is still not completely recovered from PTSD. But if this wasn't enough, he also speaks at schools and groups to help young people, and he supports the organization Mission Continues to help veterans transition back into the communities. So let me read just a couple more quotes from the interview in Parade magazine. You don't appreciate the price of freedom until you've served. Every morning on patrol, I'd see Iraqi kids living in a shack, about 10 people in one room, that barely had running water and lights. Those things humble you, and it made me wake up. I was so naive back at home. I took a lot of things for granted. It made me go back to my roots and think, my parents brought me here for a reason, and if I ever make it out of this war, I don't want to waste that opportunity. My mom and dad, they're janitors. They clean bathrooms and hospital rooms to make a living. They weren't given the opportunity to get educated or make something of themselves. So when I came back, it took a few years, but I started to realize there's more to life. Don't forget what you've seen in Iraq. I think this exemplifies what I have tried to explain today. American troops and our veterans are unique, and as I say, exceptional people. Please take the time to thank our remarkable veterans for their service. Respect them for their service to our nation and all our communities. We need to help younger veterans integrate into our communities because we need their leadership, their problem-solving abilities, and their help to keep our nation strong. Our youth need their guidance and mentorship to become good citizens. They can be great role models. Our most recent veterans have the potential to be the greatest generation. Please give them your thanks for their service and the support they need to become successful in our communities. Thank you for allowing me to talk with you here today. I am honored to be in the presence of so many great veterans. Thank you.